Welcome, folks, to another episode. Well, hello there, Scurvy. Hey, you want a nut? There you go, buddy. Welcome to another episode, an all-new episode of Imagination Nature. Hi folks, I'm Dell Cullum, and I want to welcome you to an all-new episode of Imagination Nature. In this episode, we're not going to talk about a particular species, but we're going to talk about the subject of wildlife rescue. There are many wildlife rescue volunteers dotted across Long Island, especially here on the eastern end, because we have such a wide variety of animals. These people are there day after day, 365 days a year, to help get injured, sick, and wildlife that is in need of assistance to the proper facilities, such as a local veterinarian or an animal hospital, or even to a rehab center. We have a wonderful rehab center here on the eastern end of Long Island, which actually covers quite a bit of the island. The Evelyn Alexander Wildlife Rescue Center, located in Hampton Bays, does an incredible amount of work for wildlife and educating people and about volunteering and becoming wildlife rescue folks themselves, so that we can all be spread out in areas where if a particular animal needs assistance, somebody can call and one of us can be available. Because I'm in the business of wildlife, I find myself many times in a situation that has more to do with an animal rescue than it is a job. I'm always ready to help out when I can. So this episode is really several of those situations that really weren't necessarily life-threatening, where I had the opportunity to pull out a camera and record some of these rescues. It is an important subject to cover, and these are lives we're talking about, and your help and my help and the help of all these caring individuals can make a difference and can save lives of the wildlife that we are so fortunate to have. So please enjoy this episode that I'm presenting to you with some a collection of my tidbits over the past couple of years in regards to our subject, which is wildlife rescue. Get to see these that much. You, on the other hand, get to see them a lot. Do you know that? There's so many people that don't even know we get flying squirrels.
Really?
You had two of them.
Yeah, right.
Isn't that amazing?
It is crazy, isn't it?
Yeah. He's breathing, so I don't know. He might be weak enough to let me grab him. I might not need the net. I think they breathe this carbon enough, and they get to, he's moving. Hold on, little guy. Ah, there he is. I'm gonna grab him with my hand. Got him. Ouch! You're biting me. But, that's okay. I don't need that one yet. Let me just get this. Okay. Hold on, little guy. Hold on. We just rescued this little guy. It's a flying squirrel. He's chewing on my thumb. This is a flying squirrel, and we get a lot of these around here. A lot of people don't know we do, but we do. They're very difficult to trap because they're smaller than a gray squirrel, yet they're bigger than a mouse. So they elude a standard trap. They can't be caught in a live trap, and because they would come out the holes. And as you can see, they're chewers, so they can chew themselves out of a lot of things. Many people, this one's about ready to escape. He's gonna get out in a minute. But if you can see, he's got webbing on his arms, and they're very fast. If I put him on the ground over here, you're gonna see him go up this tree. And watch. And he hides from me as he's going up the tree. But he'll get up that tree and then he'll jump and glide to another tree. They're really awesome little guys. We're fortunate here to have both the northern variety, and we also have there have been southern varieties sighted here as well. So an interesting animal, and we just pulled that one out of a fireplace. So remember, put caps on your chimneys. Just grabbed this cormorant off the beach with something stuck in his throat. Looks like a big fish. Can't seem to swallow. The call just came in and I drove down here to see what I could do. Let's see what we can do. It's okay, guy. It's okay, sweetie. It's okay. It's okay. It's okay. Well, we have an obstruction. Obviously. Hold on, sweetie. Hold on now. The bone is caught. This is a sea robin. And there we go. Hold on, baby. Hold on. We're going to get this sucker out of here for you without ripping your throat up. There you go. We did it. Can you swallow? Can you swallow? Yeah. Ooh, okay. She's got quite a grip. And now we're going to let her go. Nice and easy. Hold on, sweet pea. No biting. Okay? Go now. Hold on. Okay. We're gonna let her go. See what happens. I'm sorry I had to take your meal there, buddy. Go ahead. And what did we have? There it was. Got a sea robin. And the sea robin, the jawbone in the mouth, you see it? That sharp piece, it cut her. It punctured her. Good thing it didn't stick in her throat because she would have died. In this case, it stuck in her mouth. And that's what she was left with. Successful rescue with me and my girl Annie. Right, little girl? Hey, Mama. Well, you can see we caught Mama here in the chimney trap. I used a 45 degree cage, and then I stuck the live trap inside of that. It was forced to come into this trap, and that's what it did. So we have Mama. She's pretty calm. She's going to get a little agitated when I take her off the cage, but rightly so, not because she's aggressive, but she's scared, and she's got babies in here. So we're going to take a picture of Mama up here for the customer, and then we're going to continue getting the babies out of the chimney. These are 4 weeks. Their eyes open at 3 weeks. So their eyes just opened. So they're 4 weeks or less. I mean, they are tiny. Hi, folks. I just picked up a juvenile Cooper's hawk that had accidentally entered a residence that had a door open, lived by the water. And a gentleman called me, thought it was an osprey in his house, when in fact it seems to be a young Cooper's hawk. And I picked it up and I brought it back here, and I'm gonna just take a quick look at it and make sure it's okay. We believe it hit the window a couple times trying to get out of the residence. And it seems to be getting more energy back as time goes by. So before I bring them over to the vet to have a checkup, I'm just gonna, I'm waiting for them to open. I'm gonna give them a quick examination now. And I can already tell he's gotten a lot more alert than when I picked him up this morning. He didn't resist at all. It's okay. Seems to be okay here. All right, honey, it's okay. There we go, there we go, there we go. Okay, okay, that's what I wanted to see, Sweepy. You did great, sure. Sure, and we look at his feet, and his feet are very good. His face is good. We've got good, no blood, no anything coming out of his mouth. His eyes look clean and clear. His wings are flapping, his feet are grabbing, his talons are grabbing my fingers, and he's quite vocal, which is a good sign. None of this was relevant this morning. In fact, he just allowed me to pick him up. He didn't run or do anything. Now I can feel, and you can see the little downy feathers on his back. Okay, Sweet Pea, we're gonna take you for a little checkup, make sure your head is okay, so it's not banged up too much. All right, Sweet Pea? And we'll get you back out in the wild. We'll get you back to your mama. All right? So, ladies and gentlemen, this is a juvenile Cooper's hawk. We're back in the area where we found him, and we're going to set him back off, hopefully to get back with his family, okay? Or if it's okay to be by itself, then it will be. Okay? So here we go. Let's go, sweetie. Go ahead. Go ahead. Go ahead. So good. Hi, folks. I'm here with my little girl, Annie, and we're standing here next to the statue of St. Francis of Assisi. And we hope you enjoyed that little segment we just did. I do have a new segment that I want to start on my program. I want to talk to and introduce you to some special people. And what makes these people special? Well, the thing that makes them special is their compassion towards wildlife and their protection and preservation towards our beautiful nature and our wonderful place here that we call home. And these people have spent a lot of time and effort trying to keep things this way and to protect our resources. And I'd like to introduce you to these people because they're very special. Some of them aren't with us any longer, but nonetheless, they should be remembered for the great things that they did that still can be seen in the beautiful places here at home. In fact, that's how I'd like to start off this new segment of Imagination Nature. So let's get right into it and meet our first guest. We're here at wonderful Mainstone Park here in East Hampton, and I have a special guest with me who's going to kick off a new segment I'm going to start after each episode of Imagination Nature this season. As you see, we're next to a dedication rock for Terry E. Ganley, and I'm with her daughter, Deborah Ganley, who is visiting us from San Diego, but I happen to have grown up with Deborah. Here in East Hampton, we went to school together. Deb, tell us what makes your parents so special when it comes to the nature and the wildlife here in our area. What was their connection here, and why are they so well remembered for that?
Well, it went back when I was little. They actually met here on the water because they both fished. I remember back then, people bringing birds, because my mother loved animals, my father loved animals, to the garden center, and they had a broken wing, we had a baby raccoon, we had all kinds of animals. During the 70s, we had all those gypsy moths. He would spray for that, and one day somebody mentioned, you know, Frank Ganley came, and he sprayed our house, but there was a bird's nest. They took it down, sprayed the tree, and put the birds in. So my parents were so into nature. They loved Maidstone. I grew up here, and you could hear, I listen, and I hear the gullies and the osprey. It's just a beautiful, beautiful place. So my father unfortunately passed away in 1979. My mother worked at the garden center and took care of things, and everybody would always still ask her questions about critters. And then once my mother sold the garden center, retired, she wanted to go back and become more involved in, again, East Hampton. She loved East Hampton and everything about it, the wildlife, the waters, everything. So she was a ZBA member, board member, or she was on the ZBA review board. And she was very particular about anything that would disrupt the natural environment of East Hampton.
Sure.
And then she became very involved. She was involved with waterfowl, and she became part of the nature preserve, like the committee.
Sure, sure.
So one of the reasons of this dedication is because she really worked hard to get Maidstone Park dedicated as a nature preserve. She helped out at Pussy's Pond to get rid of a lot of invasive type of plants, and even, you know, going through and helping out with nature trails, etc.
That's a beautiful spot over there, Pussy's Pond.
I mean, as a kid, that's why I went to school at Springs, and we go over the bridge. It's gorgeous.
It's almost like the nature trail. It's a beautiful It's a perfect spot for all sorts of nature in a very unique location.
Absolutely.
Although not as unique as the nature trail, because that sits in a more central area.
Right.
But how it's fed with water,
yes.
Pussy's Pond, and that little stone, that bridge.
And
I mean, the I love seeing the egrets in there,
yes.
Early
Swans,
in the morning.
Ducks.
It's just a beautiful spot.
It really
And there's
is.
Also a dedication stone there for your mom,
yep.
At that location.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
I'm sure she spent a lot of time there
she
as
did.
Well.
She did. And every time I would come and visit her every year, and we would hit those, we would go hiking, we would walk around Maidstone and pick up the trash. It's like, right. Oh, the trash. So we'd always have our bag picking up the trash.
Even then.
Even then, that. Exactly. She's like, oh, these people with the trash. She would go out on Maidstone. She always reported how many plovers were born. Watch the osprey. I mean, we would watch the osprey for hours. And
now, didn't she also have something to do with reintroducing some...
The waterfowl.
Yes.
Oh, the waterfowl, they were wonderful, and they would bring in the baby quails, baby pheasants, baby turkeys, and they would raise them, and she loved it. But so anyway, I'd see all the turkeys, and I'm like, hi, Mom. You really, they're in town now, you know?
Yeah, right, right. And they get more and more
oh,
every
they
year.
Do. Oh, I laugh, and I'm like, oh, and everybody's, these darn turkeys.
Yeah.
And even you're outside, and you hear, like, gobble, gobble. And I'm like, oh, my gosh. And the deer, I mean, she just adored this town. And every place I go when I'm home, I see a tree my parents planted.
Sure.
There's reminders, and I love this place, and I think it should be preserved and allowed to continue the way it was when we were children. So.
Well, I absolutely agree, and that is a great way of telling the story to show that it is possible. This place is the same as it was
yes.
when I was here as a kid.
Yes, absolutely. It's
almost like the beaches are. You know, you can come back years and years, decades later, but certain places stay the same. And it's because of wonderful people like your parents, Deb, and there's
Thanks,
lots
Jeff.
There's lots more people like that.
Yes.
And I hope in this segment, each time we do an episode, I hope to find and talk to more and more people like this so we can expose these people for being awesome. Okay? Thanks, Deb. I really
Thank
appreciate it.
Thank you very much,
it.
Dell. Thanks for everything you do in town.
Right
I think
up.
You're
Absolutely.
Just wonderful.
My some treats, and the birds are eating in here too. He comes and goes as he pleases. He doesn't need to be here. He does quite well. There's his mama. Look at him still playing with his mama. Look at him. That's his stuffed animal. He loved that when he grew up. Look at him. Is that your mama, Scurvy? Is that your mama? Look at him. Look, Dee's gonna love seeing this. I mean, Scurvy played with this from the day he was brought here. He loved this thing. It was the only thing that was in his cage with him the whole time. He had mama, and then he had the baby next one. And we've pretty much cleaned the cage out here, so Scurvy would be more inclined to go out into the wild. But we always left that stuff here, just in case it was, well, for this purpose right here. And we never really knew if it worked or if he still played with it. But as you can see, he absolutely does. And I think that's just wonderful. It just shows he remembers. I'm trying to find your peanuts, Curve. Peanuts. Here's one. Here's a peanut. Got a peanut in that one. You're a good boy, Scurvy. You're a good boy. No doubt in the world that this little squirrel got a great opportunity when he was brought to us. We will credit Betsy and my sister Diane for getting this little guy to us, and then of course Dee for raising this thing, little Scurvy, right from a closed eye little squirrel to this guy right now. As you can see, he's quite happy to be alive. I don't think there's any question about that. He's just having the life, best time of his life. Okay, folks, thanks so much for joining me on this episode. It's good to be back. The summer's over. We're into fall now. We're going to have lots to discuss on the subject of nature and the beautiful surroundings we have, along with our wonderful, most beautiful wildlife. Please, folks, you can always visit me and see some of my photography and my videos and talk about animals on my website at www.imaginationnature.com. Thank you so much, and God bless.